celebrating the baby boomer lifestyle. This is Boomer Life with Stirling Fox on AM 650.
Welcome back to the program. On this episode of Boomer Life, we are talking diamonds. Our guest is Stephen Ben-Oliel of Canadian Estate Diamonds. Diamonds and gold jewelry, too, Stephen, because when people bring precious metals and jewels to you, usually a diamond is likely to be encased in a ring or a pendant or a brooch or some kind of thing. People just don't have individual little diamonds usually. They're mounted on something, aren't they?
That's correct, and we always offer them more than they'll realize anywhere else in Vancouver on the gold, because it usually represents the smallest portion of the value of the piece of jewelry when it's diamond set. So we don't want to inconvenience them to have to go to two places, one to sell their diamond, one to sell the gold. We will, of course, buy them both.
All right, now let's take a likely scenario. And you've been in the business a long time, so I don't imagine this is anything you haven't seen or heard before. But somebody comes to you, a woman comes to you, and she's got an engagement ring, and, you know, it's been around a while, and she says, "It's over. I just want this thing out of my life, and I want it now out of my life." Can you take care of that? What do you do for that client?
Well, we hear that all the time, and I guess I told you, I think, last time about the girl who told me if I didn't buy the diamond ring, she was going to throw it in the ocean.
Oh.
And so you get to see, and it's sometimes...
That's a strange threat now, isn't it?
It is, and for me, it's a tough thing, because I tend to share people's emotions, and I'm afraid that the beginning of a relationship and somebody buying a diamond, you would think that's a fortunate place to be involved in, and it is.
Of
the
course.
Diamond business lets you see the very best of humanity and, unfortunately, the dark side as well, because a diamond's become a symbol of the best of us, our aspirations, our promises, and when that goes badly, well, it you get to see the opposite,
mm-hmm.
and you get to see the bitterness. But that's why we try to be there at that point in time and show compassion and be fair, because we realize that person who's bitter today might one day want to buy a diamond again.
Sure.
And if we treat them well and understand their situation, and they don't want to be treated like they're in a pawn shop or a place that might take advantage of them, we're private. We're going to treat them fairly, and for the most part, we're going to pay them today.
Okay. Now, I'm glad you mentioned pawn shop. First of all, I haven't done this yet, and I should point out that Canadian Estate Diamonds is right in downtown Vancouver, right almost on the corner of Georgia and Granville, and you're in the old Burke's building, right?
We're in the old Vancouver block.
That's
old building with the clock on the top.
That's
right on Granville above Georgia.
Okay.
So, yeah, we're a private office. You'll sit down, and it's not a time-consuming exercise. For the most part, once we've got a diamond out of its setting, I can quantify its value in 5 minutes.
What's the difference, though, in the mindset between the way you do business and some competitors, and you've mentioned pawn shops, who seem to be, and I don't mean to tar them all with the same brush, but who seem to be quite willing to take advantage of people's misery?
Well, I hope that they aren't all of them, of course. Some compassionate's in all of us, but I believe they do offer the lowest on a used diamond in the market.
Okay.
So if you look at, they offer 10 cents on an appraised, 10 cents on the dollar on an appraised value, and an antique jeweler usually offers something in the range of 20 to 25. They can get a higher price out of us because we know exactly how we can upcycle that diamond if it's going back into the market, and the value it will realize either at a retail level or a wholesale level, because I've been wholesaling diamonds in Canada for 25 years.
Exactly. So your object here, though, the reason you're as interested in that recently divorced woman's former engagement ring, she's really anxious to get rid of it, period. So any designs you may have on it are just A-okay by her. But your practical business plan here is to purchase this diamond from this seller and recut the diamond, refashion it into something. And what do you do with the gold that it came mounted on in that original ring that you bought?
Well, because as I explained earlier, most jewelry designs change almost with the season. I mean, it's not, of course, that often, but jewelry of 10 years ago is very often not the design of today.
Okay.
So what we get for the most part just is recycled.
Oh, okay.
It's getting melted down and fashioned into some new jewelry.
Oh, I see. Okay. But your the object of the exercise from your point of view with respect to the diamonds on that engagement ring, you're looking for ways to fashion it into more contemporary, more attractive new jewelry pieces, right?
That's right. And if it's the person who owns the piece of jewelry, that's what they want to do, we can do that for them as well.
Do people, you know, in some cases, I'm sure, the woman shows up and says, get this out of my life now. Are there, however, some who are, shall we say, a little more long-range thinking than that, who say, I don't want it to look like this anymore, but it's still mine. I'd like to make it look like something a little more like what I wanted in the first place.
Sure, and it's the same case in inherited jewelry. You might want to hold on to the heirloom value, or the heirloom, the heartstring value in grandma's jewelry and never want to sell it, but you wouldn't likely wear the design of her ring.
Precisely.
So we can take that diamond out. We can refashion it, if you wish, to a modern brilliant, or leave it the way it was cut at that point in time. And you can put it into a brand new piece of jewelry, and that's usually something done within a week.
Okay, so on that heirloom, and I'm thinking again of the ring I've told you about my wife has, if the holder chooses not to refashion it into a more modern looking, more attractive package, and they'd say, no, you know, now that I know what it's worth, I think I'm just going to hang on to it and let it ride, as they would say in a card game.
Sure.
Is that, economically speaking, Stephen, is that a smart move in terms of return on the investment down the road? Will it hold its value uncut in its shall we say, ancient configuration, or if it's spiffed up, moderned up a little bit, and recut, will it actually be worth more?
If they're wishing to sell it today, it should be recut. If it's something that they're looking at as its investment value, it doesn't matter if they recut it or they leave it the way it was cut.
Okay.
And in that light, I would say they should be holding a diamond of a large size and quality, and in all the realm of diamonds, if there's a good investment, it probably is in a diamond above 1 carat of high quality.
Okay.
And if it's a 2 or 3 carat, it's going up in value, I believe, no question.
Now, did you not tell me before we started our broadcast today that diamonds have essentially doubled in value in the last 5 years?
The big and the beautiful have. Over the course of this great recession, a D flawless 3 carat has doubled in price. A 5 carat D flawless has more than doubled in price. And I think there's people look at a diamond for different reasons than just as love's greatest symbol.
Okay.
Some people will look at it as transportable wealth. You can put $1 million in your shirt pocket in times of crisis, and this was done by the Vietnamese and by people fleeing from Germany. It's the most portable commodity on earth.
Mm.
So I was once looking at a 25-carat heart shape in Antwerp, and I asked the fellow selling it because it was over $1 million. I said, who buys a diamond like this? He said, it's often an American, and it's their end-of-the-world money.
Oh.
They've got a net worth of over $10 million, and this is one part of their investment portfolio that they can hide from the world.
Mm-hmm.
So if Armageddon happens, they can flee with a lot of money. Try fleeing with $1 million in gold.
I was just going to say that. So exactly, because it's traditionally the insurance money, I'll get through any crisis with this in the basement.
That's used
to be about gold. You know,
mm-hmm.
Tough to buy a gallon of gas with a bar of gold. And I guess a 25-carat diamond's not going to get you much at the corner store either, but
no.
You can liquidate it much faster than gold.
That's right. And I'm sure in tough times, you're not going to realize everything it's worth, but it is a lot of money concentrated in a very small form.
Right. Are people and because you were talking about the anticipated shortage in 2017 of the larger class of diamonds worldwide, is that simply, Stephen, because people are holding on to them for that sort of Armageddon kind of purpose?
I believe that's part of it, and they're also now, we're at the beginning of diamond investment funds, wherein people have seen that a diamond that is now certified by the GIA or the AGS is a quantifiable commodity, they're more willing to take a chance on putting money into it as a part of their portfolio. Whether that's a big part of the future will remain to be seen.
Yeah, because diamonds have always, to my mind, been in the same category as art.
Right.
A bar of gold gets stamped and weighed, and it's all very mechanical. A diamond is like a painting. For some, at least, its value is in the eye of the beholder, and whether or not that beholder has the dough to pay the seller.
Sure, you're right, and it's interesting that you say that, because that's what Noble House is trying to achieve. We've realized that the best of what a diamond can be will be in the 21st century, and it will be because of the way that a laser can fashion a diamond that we could never do in the past. So to take a diamond to art, to the place where it's one of a kind and in the realm of a jeweler like a Fabergé, that is achievable in this century. And if I could be a part of it, well, we will be a part of it. It's just how far we can push it towards its final perfect diamond, if you will, we can be a part of. I want to be. That's fun for me.
Well, certainly. Obviously, you have a tremendous passion for this, too. Our guest on this episode of Boomer Life is Stephen Ben-Oliel, principal with Canadian Estate Diamonds and Canadian Noble House Diamonds. And we'll find out more about that part of the operation when we return after this quick timeout.
It's all about the baby boomer lifestyle. Boomer Life on AM 650.